Hi, and welcome to my talk. I'm Abram Hindle, and this is a talk about design patterns. Today we're going to talk about the composite pattern. The design intent of the composite pattern is to compose individual objects to build a tree-like structure. And usually, you can deal with these objects uniformly. So an example of a tree structure would be a folder that contained files and other folders. It would be your HTML DOM, where DOM elements like divs contain other divs. It would be any kind of tree you can think of in that way. Other kinds of trees would be an abstract syntax tree of a programming language. Another kind of tree that could exist would be mathematical expressions. Furthermore, each of these individual objects gets treated uniformly. So basically you have two kinds of nodes. You have like a leaf node, which terminates, like say a file, and then you have a branch node, like say a folder. And they can both have similar interfaces. They could both say give their name out, and they could also give their size. In the case of a file, size might be the size of the file. In the case of a directory, size might be the recursive sum of all the file sizes contained within that directory. So, think recursive decomposition. You've got a file, right? And it can be contained by a folder. A folder can contain a file or a folder, and it can contain many of them. So you could have a folder containing a folder, containing a folder, containing a folder, containing zero files. Or you could have a folder containing a folder and a file. But technically you don't know, because you got to remember, computers are relatively blind. They don't see much. When you're at this folder, you don't know how many folders deep this one folder branch can be. You'd have to go here and explore it. Nonetheless, each one of these components in the composite could return, say, its name or its size. So if you ask the size of this thing, what it would probably do is it'd probably give you the size of all the files summed together. So, in UML, the composite structure is basically like this. You have your main component, like a named item, and you've got your leaf node, file, and you've got folder. In this case, the only shared functionality is that we have get name. Folders can be composed of multiple named items. They can be aggregated of multiple named items. Furthermore, folders and files share the type named item. Folders can have zero or more named items. A file isn't a container, so it does not aggregate anything. The general structure of this would be that a component is contained by a composite, and you also have a leaf kind of node. We're just using the word leaf here because it means the end of a tree. So, what is a component, and what is a composite, and what is a file in this diagram? Well, all of these bubbles are basically components. The folders are composites, while the files are basically the leaves. So, thus, the composite pattern builds up a recursive structure by having all the subcomponents share similar functionality. All right? Another thing is, you might have, in your composites, you might share the idea of has children. So, you could have the idea that every node might have children, but your leaf node might be childless nodes. For instance, In HTML, an image tag tends to be childless except for the description of the tag. Also, a paragraph tag oftentimes is descriptionless. Nonetheless, composite works well with recursive decomposition. So in this case, you could think we have a folder, we could ask for its children, we could get the name of each one of its children, then for every other folder, we could get the name of its children. All right. So that is basically the composite structure. You have leaves, and you have composites. Now, we'll discuss the command pattern. The command pattern is a nice pattern that encapsulates intent, and it's fundamentally OO in the sense that it takes an action, like a command, and it turns it into a class and instantiated objects. Basically, commands are oftentimes requests. So a request could be something as simple as get an HTML page over HTTP. It could be to run, to queue, to log, any of these requests. Furthermore, the command pattern takes advantage of object-oriented programming to allow us to implement arbitrary flow controls, so we can say run things, queue them, run them in parallel, log them as they do them, undo or redo requests, because we've encapsulated one unit of work to be done, but we've also encapsulated the intent. So, think about this motivation. You have a class and you want to issue a request without knowing anything about the operation being requested or the receiver object for that request. This means you might want to decouple classes from each other. A good example would be if you wanted to implement keyboard shortcuts that saved a file, that saved the current file in an editor, or if you had the menu item where you could save the file. So I'll give you an example here. So given this gvim graphical editor, I can make a file and then I can write it to temp. So I can write it that way. I can save it this way. So I can choose save here, or I can run this command. So this command, W, tells gvim to save the file, but this menu item also runs that command. So that means the command is being given to vim in two different ways, but it's one command. It's this command, and this command gets interpreted. That's basically the command pattern, where the menu bar here shouldn't really care too much about the file that I'm reading or what's in the editor, but it should allow me to execute those commands. Essentially, we take a request and we make the request a command object. This allows us to store it, run it, and pass it around. For instance, if we go back to gvim, I can make a macro where this text is stored in that macro. So if I go QA, now it's recording, then I go escape colon W save, okay, and now I end the macro, okay? So now it's no longer recording. If I go at A, it runs that macro, but if I go A paste, you can see that it recorded the macro. It recorded that command. So when I run the macro, it's executing multiple commands. Escape, colon W, enter. That's what it's really running. So that's basically like a command pattern. So example uses would be like the gvim example. You basically want to pull the logic out of the interface classes and turn them in command objects. This means you have multiple interfaces to interact with the program. A good example is copy and paste. Do you want to re-implement copy and paste in many different cases? Furthermore, do you want menu bars aware that you've highlighted text? Do you want them aware of the text that you've highlighted? Do you want a special case to copy and paste? So consider those options. This means if we could just make a paste command or a copy command, it could resolve all the dependencies necessary. Furthermore, it would mean that our menu bar would not be dependent on that. Commands also allow you to make a bunch of command primitives, basically atoms, and that your backend application can understand. Then you can execute these atoms as you wish. Commands are also nice in the sense that you might want to serialize a command. For instance, you might send the JSON. You might send the JSON get, and then you might have the args. So you might send this as a command, and then because it is a command, it can be deserialized into the get command object with those arguments, and then you can execute that command. So one of the neat things about the command pattern is that we can use it to specify queue and run commands. We have control over its flow control. Furthermore, we can run these things at different times. We could run them in parallel, we could do things like that. It also allows us to support undo. So if the state can be undone, if the change in state can be undone, then we could undo it. This allows us to basically execute commands stored in a history list. So if we execute a command, we can put it into a history list, then when we call the undo command can inspect that history list and decide if it can undo that action. Commands also can allow us to implement a kind of callback function where we run a command and it can call back to other code to deal with the result of that command. This is especially good if your result is going to be asynchronous. A good way to use this pattern is to basically store a log of executed commands. This allows you to reapply the commands if the system crashes. It also allows you to repeat work and maybe even make macros. Another situation is when you want to make a set of primitive commands, and then you can have transactions that group coherent commands together, and they operate on the data in a coherent manner. So you could think of, say, like taking money out of a bank account might be modeled well as a command, and if part of that command wasn't possible to be executed, you'd want the whole thing to be undone and rolled back. So I've been talking very, very abstractly about the command pattern. Really, what a command is it's an object that you have that you can call execute on. If you can undo, you might want unexecute or is reversible to indicate that it is unexec you can unexecute it, which means to undo it. So you'd have a general interface of this command. You could execute, unexecute, you could be reversible. And then you can make concrete commands like copy and paste, which have their own version of execute and unexecute. The copy and paste commands might have their own context as well, like they might know that they're part of a buffer or something like that, or they might have text associated with them. What you also will often do is you'll have a receiver class where you can actually execute that action, and the command will attempt usually aggregate the receiver classes, which might be a buffer or a file. In the case of an editor, it might be the buffer. For instance, in GVim, this editor here, this buffer right here, would probably be the recipient of the action. Because I could always make a new file and then have multiple buffers, right? So it might be important to know which buffer I want to deal with. Furthermore, while you'll have a model class that will receive the action, you probably will have a controller or invoker class that will manage the commands and ask a command to execute, and also be responsible for scheduling and running the commands and probably overseeing their execution. Oftentimes, we'll call this an invoker. Technically, you don't need either of these too much, but this is the basic structure. Here's an example. We've got a command class, could be an abstract class, could be an interface. We've got a paste command and a save command. They can both execute and unexecute, and they might be reversible. So a paste command, to execute a paste command, you might just insert text into a buffer. To unexecute a paste command, you might go to that position in the buffer and delete that string that you pasted. When you call isReversible, it will return true. When you have a save command, you can execute it by writing to disk. You can't really unexecute it because it's IO, and IO happens, and it's impossible to unexecute that event, but you can also fake it if you want. In general, save commands won't be reversible, unless when you save, you make a backup of the file as you save it, or a backup of the state such that you could unexecute it and reverse it by simply restoring the old version. So you have to consider whether or not your command is truly reversible or not. If it was, say, a command sent over a network, like say, send an HTTP request, you can't unexecute an HTTP request. You might be able to unexecute what the HTTP request does, but you can't necessarily undo it unless there is a context-specific method. I/O, the saving and writing of files and the interaction over the network, typically is not reversible. The result, the consequence of using this pattern, is it decouples the object that invokes operation from the one that knows how to perform it. Again, this means that this paste operation can be completely ignorant of the context here, but it's up to the paste command to actually know how to execute that operation. Furthermore, it is easy to add new commands or manipulate them because they're first class objects. So, let's go over an example with undo redo. Every command that we execute, we will add to the history list. So when we execute one command, we can unexecute it if it's on the history list by calling unexecute on it. Then, when it is unexecuted, we can put it back on a redo list such that we can redo what we undid. Because sometimes you undo too much and you have to go back and redo it. Then, if we want to redo, we can go to the redo list and we can unexecute it. So we can have like this queue of commands on the history list and we can redo and unexecute them. The example abstract implementation of a command could be something like this. You could use an interface, but perhaps you want to provide a default is reversible or a default unexecute. In this case, we got execute, unexecute is reversible. Here, we have an implementation of a paste command. We have a document that's going to be a receiver, and we are going to initialize a paste command using the document, the position, and the string text. We can usually inspect this from the current editor. In our paste, we take the document, the position, and the text. To execute the command, we insert the text at that position. To delete the text, we assume that that position is safe, we move to that position, and we delete the text that is that length, and it will undo that paste. You can think of it like this. If I copy here, right, and then I paste it, it's going to add that. That is 5 characters long. To undo that, I would delete 5 characters. So I can go 5D, or DC, no. I can go 5X and it deletes it. So X deletes characters. So to undo inserting here, I could go 4X, or 4x. No, that didn't work. Anyways, the point is that I can delete text by deleting text at the position. Furthermore, we indicate that we have an unexecute and this command is reversible. Our command manager will look like this. We'll have a history list, a redo list, and our command manager will implement them both. We'll implement them as a linked list. We'll use the linked list like a stack. When we invoke a command, we execute it. If it's a reversible command, we'll add it to the history list. If the command is not reversible, we won't allow any undo to happen, so we will clear the history list because it is no longer possible to undo anything. If the redo list contains any elements, we will clear it. We will do this because we'll only keep one level. We'll basically only really keep one level of redo when we actually execute something. When we redo something, we'll deal with the redo list on our own. Our undo method will go through the history list and say, if the size is greater than 0, remove the first command off that list and unexecute it. If we unexecute it, redo it, add it to the redo list. if we ever call redo, make sure there's something on the redo list, and then remove it from the list, execute it, and add it back to the history list. So, if we called undo four times, we'd have four items on the redo list, which would mean that we could call redo four times, and it would undo it in that order. Here, we make a singleton command pattern, we get a command manager, and we can get it. But nonetheless, undo and redo are pretty simple. They don't have to worry about what cutting and pasting is, because they maintain that state, and they have a very simple interface of execute and unexecute. To invoke the command manager, we can get a hold of it, we can make a new command, here a paste command, and then we can invoke that command. We could also do things like queue command, where we could change the flow control. So consider whether or not you want to support multi-level undo redo. The command state may include receivers, the arguments used, and original arguments. So to undo something, you oftentimes have to remember what you undid. So delete command will have to remember what was deleted. And furthermore, some requests cannot be undone. Saving documents, global search and replace sometimes are too much effort to restore. You can, using the command pattern, if your commands are relatively atomic, you can actually make macro commands. I want you to think right now how you would make a macro command. This is to assemble a command into a command sequence to be run. So, think about this, stop the video, consider how you do this, and I'll be back once I count down to five. So stop the video. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So how would you build a macro command? Could you use a design pattern that you used before? So here's an example code of a macro command. Macro command extends command. It has an array list of commands that it will run. And then it takes that array list, keeps it, allows you to add commands, and then allows you to execute, and allows you to execute by going command execute. This means that if we wanted to go paste, 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 cut, we could insert a list of paste, 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 cut into the macro command, then we would have a macro command that we could rerun, much like the macros I showed you in gvim. Remember, we had that A macro? So this is what that A macro looked like, which was press escape, go colon W, and press enter. Right? So if I want to save this file because I've made a modification, what I can do is I can go ampersand A, and now it saved the file because it runs that command, which is an aggregation of commands. So the macro command is basically the composite pattern. We've got command, we got concrete command, and we got macro command. Macro command is composed of zero or more commands. And because this pattern is used, a macro command is a command, we can compose a macro of macros. So that's really neat. Imagine if I started recording another macro, which saved twice. So I could go save once, save twice. So let's look at that command. It says at A. So it runs this twice. That would be a macro command. That would be a hierarchy of commands. Okay, in the next talk, we'll talk about the template method pattern. But in this talk, we talked about composite pattern, and we talked about commands. Commands are very powerful because they allow us to abstract intent and actions into objects. Commands can also be run in different ways, and we can also deal with flow control in different ways, especially ways that the user wants us to deal with them in terms of undo and things like that. Remember that the composite pattern, which we eventually used in the macro command, consists of a component that has shared functionality between composites, which contain other components, as well as leafs, which don't contain other components. Notice with the macro command that we composed two patterns together. We compose the command pattern and the composite pattern.